As you guys can see in the video, for those of you that don't know me, that aren't quite as familiar with Metro, I live a very different kind of life than most of you. That's not good, it's not bad, it's just different. It's just different. And today will reflect that, just so you guys know that. After you've been stabbed twice, had your ribs broken, had your jaw broken, been in three airplane crashes, and been shot in the head, I'm not here to entertain you. Most of you guys know that. Today can be this unique time, and that's really my prayer. I spent some time last night just kind of thinking about where I wanted to go today. And one of the things I've said on this tour, I've talked about water boiling at 100 degrees. Listen to me. Look at me. I need y'all to get this. When the water hits 100 degrees, something happens. When the fire has been in contact with that water for X amount of time, there's a moment in time, one moment, when that thing hits 100, and when that happens, guys, the entire form, shape of the water changes. As a matter of fact, I'll take it one step further. It almost becomes unrecognizable compared to what it was in its former shape. Are you with me? So my prayer for some of you today, all of you won't get this. I've been in the ministry almost 50 years. I'm smart enough to know not all y'all's gonna get this, but some of you gonna get this. For some of you this morning, I've got, I don't know what, 45, 50 minutes. Is that clock right? Yes? What finger is she holding up? It's a thumb, okay. I couldn't tell. I live in New York. I always have to look at which finger it is. I'm just saying. All right. But for some of you, today is going to be your 100-degree day. Not all of you, because some of you didn't come prepped for that, and that's cool. Maybe next week, if you got any sense, sometimes before the end of the year, maybe some of y'all get this. But my prayer for some today, this day, in the next today will be that day. Usually, when you reach your defining moment in life, you really don't wake up that day and think that today is going to be that day that will change an entire direction and purpose of your life. Most folks that I know, I sat with Billy Graham years ago. You would be shocked at how ordinary a guy, when you get him away from the hubbub, how ordinary a guy he is. He's old now, retired. Very seldom do people wake up that day and say, okay, today's my day. You just wake up, go through the motions, and then you're minding your own business, and something will happen to you. It will affect you for the rest of your life. That's what happened to David. He was on his way to lunch, taking lunch to his brothers. Be careful today on your way to lunch. Just throwing it out there, guys. Just throwing it out there, okay? I hope today, I pray today, I believe today that for some of you, this year going to be your 100-degree day. Are you ready for that kind of change? Okay, that was a reaction. That was not a response. So let me say it again for the cheap seats. Are you ready for such a dramatic change in your life that you may become unrecognizable. Okay, that wasn't bad. It's better than I expected. All right. I hope that's that kind of day. It was the late 1800s. There was a man by the name of Robert Moffat. He was preaching in an auditorium in central London. He just came back from Africa, and he saw something while he was there. Look at me. He saw something. Log that, because I'm going to keep pushing you. I'm going to poke you today. I'm going to poke you in the eye. Okay? Why? Because for some folks, that's what it takes to get some people's attention. You got to... I don't wear that bulletproof vest just for the video, just so you know. There's places I go in the world, I have to wear the vest. I carry a gun while I preach, so don't make me come out there. Because you know I will. You saw how I dealt with the security guy, okay? And I was easy on him, okay? Moffat said in Africa, he saw the smoke of 1,000 villages where the gospel had never been preached. The smoke from 1,000 villages. Nobody heard the gospel. And right up in the corner of the balcony, there was a young man. He heard that one statement, the smoke of 1,000 villages, and it connected with him. Meeting's over. Moffat's at the back, shaking hands with people. So this young man comes up to Moffat, says, "Dr. Moffat, do you just need somebody to go? Is that what you need?" Moffat looks at the guy and says, "Yes, I need somebody to go." And the young man said, "Yes." You know who the young man was. The young man was David Livingstone. Oh, but some of you don't even know that name, do you? Shame on you. Shame on you. Names like David Livingstone, Hudson Taylor, Adoniram Judson, George Mueller, Charles Spurgeon, John Wesley, David Brainerd. But you only know Lady Gaga. Why is that? Why is that? You don't know the story about the one-way missionaries, do you? Never heard them, have you? Yeah. When they decided to go to the mission field, they would take all their earthly belongings that they felt like they needed on the field. They would buy a coffin, and instead of putting their stuff in a suitcase, they would put it in the coffin, wrap it up, and they would bring it with them to the mission field. Because they knew the only way they'd be coming back is in the coffin themselves. But you don't hear stories like that anymore, do you? No. Why is that? Why is that? Maybe you need to answer that question for your own self. Yeah. That little video intro that chicken guy made for me, the crazy guy. They're exactly right. People look at me like I'm not quite on track. Shot, plane crashes, fist fights, got thrown off of a building, seen 22 people murdered. You ever see somebody get their head cut off? Now you haven't, have you? I have. I don't live like you. What does that mean? It means at some point in your life, you have to decide what you want to do with what you have left. Isn't it interesting that only 1.5% of the world's population ever does anything significant with their life? That's not my stats. That's world stats. 1.5% of the entire population of the world ever does anything significant. Now, significance is relevant or relative. I understand that. Some people think, well, I got up this morning. That's significant. Well, for some of you, it may be. That may be the most important thing you've done all week. What is significant to you? What do you, look at me, what do you want to do with what you got, man? With what you got. I'm going to be asking you a question today in light of Moffat's statement and how it affected Livingston, who gave his life for the African people. I will be asking you a question, and I will repetitively keep asking you the question till you answer it for yourself, not collectively, but individually. I just finished a PhD at the University of Wales, so I was going to make you call me doctor, but I changed my mind. Because then I found out that Chin is the pharmacist. That's apparently an internal joke that most of you would not have picked up. And that's fine. That's a green room illustration. And we'll leave it there. So in light of Moffat saying he saw the smoke of a thousand village, in light of Livingston catching it, because as we all know, some things are taught and other things are caught, he caught the statement. I will ask you the question today, what do you see? What do you see? Because what you see, how you choose to see needs, life, ministry, that will greatly determine what you end up doing with the rest of your life. Let's see where today goes, shall we? Let's see what happens. I'll be at the back table. I have no idea where it is. I think it's out there somewhere. Is that in the lounge? The lobby? The lounge, the vestibule, the foyer, depending on which country you're in. That's where I'll be. A couple of things out there. Let me tell you about them real quick so we won't have to answer the same question 50 times. The book, Whose Child Is This? If you can get a close-up of that, cameraman. This is now in 35 languages. Really has been the key to kind of getting people to see things beyond themselves. Has just been selected actually this year as the most influential Christian biography this year in the United States. So if you want a gift, a good Christmas gift for a friend of yours that needs a kick in the pants, this is a kick in the pants gift, all right? If you have not read this book, who has not read this book? You have not read this book. Hold up your hand. Let me see your hand. What is wrong with you people? What is wrong? All right, who hasn't read the book? Again, hold up your hands. Let me see. You guys haven't read this book? Here you go. Merry Christmas. All right. The other ones now are textbooks in universities and some of the larger churches in the world. Teflon Rhino. If you're going to make it in life, you got to have skin thick as a rhino made out of Teflon. Nothing sticks to you. You don't get offended. Nothing bothers you. Okay, I just finished this one. I dedicated it to the Malaysian Christians. It's called Running with Turtles. You ever have a friend that says, hey, you're doing too much for God, you go to church too much, you need to slow down? You get this book, and then when somebody says that to you, you pick up the book, and you hit them in the head with it, in Jesus' name. Just smack them. Smack them in the head. All right. Anybody else want a book? Yeah. You can buy them right in the lobby, right out there. Come on, Jesus. Right out there in the lobby. What else we got? A couple of DVDs. If I say something today that makes sense, and you guys say, I'd like to know more about that. People ask quite a bit about the internship, the 4-month internship. internship. I think it's the only free internship program in the world. We have people come to New York, spend 4 months with us, immersed in the ministry. It's a great, what is it, tool, I guess, would be a good word, for people to see if you've got what it takes to cut it in ministry. So all that's on the website, which is metroworldchild.org. But the DVDs, we have DVDs for normal Christians, and we have DVDs for not normal Christian. I don't know what you guys are. I'm looking up there at the cheap seats. I'm watching you, cheap seats. The normal one, this was made by BBC. It's a one-hour documentary. They filmed it just after I got shot in the head and lived. So they said, well, there's the title. So they called it The Legend of Bill Wilson. You didn't know I'm a legend. Now you know. Now you know. Come on, Jesus. Come on. This is pretty much for all audiences. You won't get offended with this. The other one, however, this is a number 18 tape. It was made by ABC. It shows where I live and the people I live with. It's unedited. It's uncut. So the language, the pictures reflect my other life, where I live in the ghetto in New York. This isn't for kids. It's actually not even for most Christians. But if you want to see that side of my life, we've got that. And last, and I saved this for last, I didn't talk about this when I was here a couple years ago, but Pastor has allowed me to share this with you. And so to me, this is the most important thing that you guys will see on the table. These are pictures of some of the kids that we have committed our lives to, literally. In the introduction, they made a reference to my mother leaving me on a street corner. She was alcoholic. She walked away. She never came back. And as you heard, I sat on the corner for 3 days. No food, no water. Until a very ordinary Christian stopped. Not the pastor, not an evangelist, not someone from the board of deacons. Things just come over me sometimes. Just an ordinary Christian. His own son was dying in the hospital. He stopped, got me some food, made some phone calls, and 5 hours. 5 hours after that meeting on a street corner, he's put me in a church van, sends me to the Sunday school camp where, as you heard, that's where I gave my life to Christ and everything changed. Listen to me. Everything changed. Everything. Everything. Yeah. That's what this is, guys. You will have a chance today when you get out of here to pick a child that was just like me. The reason I am so passionate about our sponsorship program, I was this kid. I was the kid nobody wanted. I was the kid nobody cared about. That man put something into motion when he stopped that day. That's now, well, the 154,000 that we had in Metro Sunday School last week. People see me on television. They see me in this kind of a venue. That's great. I write the books. I teach in university. I do all that. That's great. But the reality is, the 154,000 that heard the story of Jesus last week, really, that was made possible. Because in 1961, one man stopped to pick me up. He put it in motion that day. That's what this is, guys. It's 120 ringgit a month. You can be as involved in the life of the child as you choose to be. If you can't do it by yourself, a couple of you may be able to get together. I don't know. I don't know who's here. I don't know where you guys are at. But I know this. This is an opportunity to do, as I said, for one kid, like the guy did for me. And if you ever wondered, does this kind of stuff make a difference? Because I know, you see a lot of stuff on TV, especially from America. I have to live with those idiots, so I understand. Okay, I don't like them either, because they just make my job harder. So you wonder, does this stuff really do something? I was in Ethiopia, and it was one of those difficult trips for me, tough trip. And I just got to the orphanage, and one of the staff members said, "Pastor Bill, we heard there's a little girl that's chained to a tree out in the jungle." So you guys know me. I'm going, okay, has anybody looked? Did it occur to anybody? No, of course not. Nobody went. I said, give me the keys to the Jeep. Let's go. So we jump in the Jeep, 2 hours. We're driving around. Finally, we find this kid. I'm sure some of you guys are sharp enough in your cultural understanding. In a lot of parts of the world, girls are not valued. You all know that. Parts of India, lots of Africa, girls just, they're not valued. It's another story. We don't have time to get into that. So this family wanted a boy. They ended up with the girl. Her name's Rosie. They kept her for a while, and then they just decided they didn't want her anymore. I understand that. So they took her out to the bush, took a chain, tied her hands and her legs to this tree, and just left her. They've been trying to starve her to death. I guess she didn't die fast enough. So they take her out, chain her to the tree, and we find her. And I had a little hacksaw. So get out, I cut the chain, I pick her up, get her in the Jeep. We get her back to the orphanage. Chin, do you have that first picture? I want you guys to see this. This is Rosie. I show this to you guys because you and I both know I can't explain this. You all know how this goes. I could try to explain it. It ain't going to happen. You got to see it. So this was, I took this picture myself in the orphanage. And I thought, okay, maybe I could get her a sponsor. So I was going back to the States. 2 days later, I was preaching in a pastor's conference. And I thought, maybe I can get somebody to sponsor. So I took this picture that you see here. I put it in the folder, like you guys will see out there. So I get done preaching. I'm at the back table, like you'll see me after the service. And a family comes up, and the mom was very outspoken. And she said, "Pastor Bill, we want to sponsor Rosie." And I said, "That's great, but I can't tell you that she's even going to be alive in a couple weeks." The lady said, "Doesn't matter. We want to try to save her life." So we had them sign the card. They took the packet. They were great, great sponsors. You know, there's good sponsors, and then there's good sponsors. These folks were great. Faithful in their monthly pledge. They bought what do you call it, like a bunch of nutrients, shipped it to Ethiopia. So trying to put some weight on her. I got a chance to get back there about 6 months after all this, and I wanted to check on Rosie. Chin, can you give me the next picture? That's 6 months. Come on, give God a praise. Come on. This 6 months, guys, 6 months. I needed to show you this because you need to get in your heads the very simple biblical truth that one person can make a difference. I have a sermon I've preached all over the world, Standing Between the Living and the Dead, from the book of Numbers. The classic biblical illustration of how one person can make a difference. This, guys, is an illustration of that message, how one person can stand between life and death. I show you this so you understand that when you leave today, I'll get you out of here in enough time. Stop by, take a look. If you can help us, help these kids. That's what today's about. That's what it's about. I appreciate it. Thanks, guys. Thank you very much. Thanks, Chin. You can take that down. Once you get your Bibles open, very quickly, I want to talk to you for a few moments. If you don't have a Bible, slip over next to a Christian. They'll have one. In the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter, it's one of those interesting narratives that most preachers and teachers use, particularly around the Easter season, to illustrate, or what's another word I can use? I want to use some big words so I can feel like my PhD was worth the money. So I may just throw some big words out just to try to impress you. If I do, interpreters, I don't know where they are. Are they in that little glass room up there? Is that where they are? Oh, they're over here. Hey, guys, I'll try to keep it easy for you. The most common text that teachers slash preachers would use is this 20th chapter of John, because in this, the bulk of the chapter is used to try to convey the Easter message. Now, what do we have here in this 20th chapter? We have three of Jesus's closest friends that come on Easter Sunday. They look in the empty tomb, and we would have to ask them the same question I'm going to keep asking you guys. What do you see? What do you see? Isn't it interesting that even when I put that picture of Rosie up there, I'm very aware of the crowd where I'm speaking. Like right now, the security guys think I'm looking straight ahead, but I'm actually looking at them. If you live in the ghetto for 35 years, like I have, you learn to have a full range of sight. I'm watching you guys over there. How is it that when you saw Rosie, some of you went, some of you just gave it the dog look. You know what the dog look is. It's when you talk to your dog and your dog goes, that's the dog look. Mm-hmm. Just keep that in mind. Some of you put your hand up to your face. A couple of you, I noticed quickly, looked down. Why is that? What makes the difference between someone that sees something and it connects and it doesn't stir you, but it moves you? Big difference between being stirred and being moved, isn't it? We're stirred easily, but we're not moved quite as easily, are we? Keep it in mind, because I'll come back to that. You all saw the same picture, the before and the after. Some of you had connected with others. It was just a National Geographic picture. Didn't click, did it? I know. I get it. In this 20th chapter of John, you've got Mary, Peter, and John. They come to the empty tomb Sunday morning. Now remember, guys, they all knew Jesus. They knew the man personally. They heard his message first person, first hand. They saw the miracles up front. Have you ever seen a real miracle? Like, not in a book, not on some TV show. I'm like talking like you were there, witness, first person. You ever see a miracle, a real miracle? If you haven't, I pray before you die, you will have that privilege. I pray that you'll... have that privilege. When I got hit with a brick years ago, broke my cheekbone, broke all my teeth out, I was blind in this eye. discouraged, getting ready to quit the ministry. Most of you that know me know I'm not a quitter. My commitment has always been stronger than my emotions. That's worth you writing down. That's a tweet moment. For those of you that tweet, tweet that, you little tweeters. You may want to tweet that. Your commitment has got to be stronger than your emotions, or you ain't going to make it. You ain't going to make it. Because when the going gets tough, you out. You'll quit. You'll call 1-800-CRY-BABY. You want somebody to feel sorry for you. It ain't me, babe. I ain't going to feel sorry for you. I'll slap you upside the head in Jesus' name. But I will slap you. Blind in this eye for 3 months, getting ready to quit. It was a Sunday night. I remember it like it was yesterday. I was leaving New York on Monday morning. Wasn't even telling anybody. Didn't even have the guts to tell people I was a quitter. Couldn't sleep. My whole life was about to change. I set the alarm for 6 a.m. I must have went to sleep for a little bit. I remember looking at the clock about 3 a.m. I guess I dozed off. The alarm goes off at 6. I turn it off. I turn on the light. My pillow was covered with blood, and I could see fine out of both eyes. Somewhere between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m., God came. God came. What does that mean to you? It means the reason why most people never see their miracle is because they don't stick around long enough. If you stay long enough, it may come down to the last minute, but God comes. You better give God a praise right about there. Right about there. But you got to stay. You got to stay with it. Well, I don't know. I'm tired. Shut up. Got nothing to do with nothing. Your commitment always has to be stronger than your emotions. I hope you get to see. See, really, you're looking at a living miracle here. You never thought a miracle would look like this, did you? I know. It's a little disheartening. I understand. Just pay attention because we're going somewhere. All right? Mary, Peter, John, they knew the man. They heard the message. They'd seen the miracles. And now they're looking in an empty tomb. If anybody should have understood what they were looking at, it should have been them, correct? They heard him. They knew him. They saw him. They experienced the power of Christ. And now they're looking in an empty tomb. And I have to ask them the question that I'm asking you. What do you see, Mary? What do you see, Peter? How about you, John? What do you see? Jen, give me the next picture, if you will, please. What do you see here? Looks like a pregnant woman laying on a hospital bed. This was in the Dominican Republic. Two of our girls were finishing Metro Sunday School, driving back to the headquarters. This lady was laying on the side of the road. Looked like she'd been hit by a car. Blood coming out of her nose, blood coming out of her mouth. The girls pull the Sunday School truck over, jump out. They don't speak Spanish really well, but they were trying to talk to her, and she was barely conscious. So they pick her up. Watch this. Get her in the truck. Get her to the hospital. When they get her to the hospital, they find out she's not pregnant at all. Chin, you got the next shot there, hon? Let me see what you got next. This tumor had been growing inside this woman, obviously, for years. Years. What do you see now? The existential question, is it not? I think it is. 60 seconds ago, you thought you were looking at a pregnant woman. You were wrong, weren't you? I wonder what else you could be wrong about. Interesting question, isn't it? Sometimes we think we see something when in reality we're not even close. Take that down, chin. See, when I choose to come to Malaysia, I make a conscious choice to come into your world. I like it here. I like the people. I do. I enjoy coming here. It's been a while. I forgot how much I really like hanging out with you guys. But for these few moments this morning, see, I choose to come into your world, but now I'm bringing you into my world. Are you okay with that? Everybody all right? You all right so far? This is my world, folks. Welcome to my world. I told you, I don't live like you, do I? No, I don't. Two worlds coming together this morning, isn't it? Yeah. Not an easy task when you try to bring two diametrically opposed cultures, worlds together. But let's let the Holy Ghost do what he wants to do. In that first verse of that 20th chapter, Mary comes to the tomb. She looks in. Let's see what she says. Let's take a look at it. She looks in. She came early. I don't need a spotlight. I can read it. What are you all doing? I'm not that old. Oh, Jesus, help us. All right. She sees the stone had been taken away. Now watch this. She's looking, guys, at what you and I would call a fulfilled prophecy. Correct? Because Jesus said he would die. He said 3 days later he would rise. And now she sees the stone is moved. She obviously sees the tomb is empty. Let's take a look at it here. Now, I don't know what version y'all are using, if you're using the Malaysian version or whatever Bible y'all read. She sees the stone. She sees the whole thing. That word see or seeth there in that first verse, in the Greek language, it's the Greek word blepo. B-L-E-P-O. Blepo. What does that mean? I'm not going to talk to you in Greek today. I'm not going to bore you with that. But this one word is critical. That word blepo in the Greek means she sees the stone has moved. She's obviously seeing the empty tomb, but she doesn't get it. It doesn't, how can we say, it doesn't connect with her. She just sees with her eyes. She sees the obvious. Oh, stone's moved. Oh, I guess the tomb's empty. Oh, she doesn't, God help us, she doesn't understand what she's looking at. How in the name of anything that's intelligent is that possible? How can that be? She knew the man, correct? She saw the miracles, correct? She heard the message, correct? She knew everything that she should have known. She should have known exactly what she was looking at. She didn't get it. You tell me, guys. You tell me. How's that work? How's that work? If anybody should have understood, should have been Mary. She should have caught it, looked at it, and said, oh, he rose. He did it. Got it. But instead, it's the word blepo. She didn't get it. Chin, you got another picture? Give me another shot there. This little boy's name is Jason. That's his father in the New Zealand shirt. This is in Kenya. I just finished talking to the vice president of the country in this meeting. The father had heard I was in town. He brought me his son. He said, could you pray for my boy? I said, of course. So I prayed. Give me another shot, Chin. I think we have another one there. So I prayed for the boy. And you guys know why these tumors happen. Quite common there. See, they drink water that's full of who knows what. And normally, by the time, like he was, I think he's 9. So by the time a kid gets 6, 7, 8, 9, this bacteria has built up so much in their body that it manifests itself like this. Typical in developing countries where they don't have access to clean water. You all know this. So I pray for the boy. There were some other preachers in the meeting, along with the politicians, because the vice president was there, and it was a photo op for the stupid politicians. So I'm thinking, okay, let me get some of the preachers to come together. We'll all lay hands on the tumor and pray. The minute I went like this, and I went to get the preachers, they knew, because they knew me. They scattered like roaches when the light comes on, right? They're gone. None of them wanted to put their hand on the tumor. Why is it then that some folks see the need and they go towards the need, and other people, come on, Jesus, come on. What do you see? I'm going to keep poking you till you answer this. What do you see? What do you see? Just another little black kid that's going to die anyway? Is that what you see? You tell me. Take it down, Chen. Mary looks, stones moved, tomb's empty, but it's blepo. She doesn't get it. Sound like anybody we know? I don't know. The next one shows up. You can read it for yourself. It's in verse 6. Peter shows up. He looks in. Let's see what that says. Peter looks in, and he sees the linen clothes, the empty linen clothes, the grave clothes, empty. He looks in. Grave clothes are empty. Tomb is empty. He sees basically the exact same thing that Mary sees. And in your Bible, it's the same word as in verse 1. See or seeth, depending on what version you're looking at. Same word, but it's not in the Greek. Isn't that interesting? In verse 1, when Mary looked in, it was the Greek word blepo. She just sees with her eyes. Doesn't connect. But in verse 6, when Peter looks in, he sees it. It's the Greek word theorio, which is where we get the English word theory. Peter looks in and says, is it possible? He said he would rise. I don't know. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. I'm not sure. I think he might have, but what is he doing? He's putting together a what? A theory, a hypothesis of some sort, trying to figure out Mary. God help us. Mary only saw it with her eyes. Peter looks at it with his mind. Isn't that interesting? They're looking. God, help me to get this across to my friends. God. How is it possible, guys? How's it possible? They both knew the man. They both saw the miracles. They heard the same message from Jesus. Mary looks in. She has no clue of what she's looking at. Peter's trying. It's all about the mind. That's kind of like this culture. Education is God in this part of the world, isn't it? Yeah, I get it. I come here a lot. Yeah. I know guys in New York. They got earned PhDs. They're homeless living under a bridge. So if you think having a piece of paper on your wall is going to make you something, hate to tell you, folks, but you're sadly mistaken. Peter just sees with his mind. I think Peter was from Malaysia. I don't know that for sure. I can't prove that scripturally, but I'm thinking he was Malaysian. Because it's all about this, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah. What do you see, Mary? blepo. What do you see, Peter? Theorio. Chin, you got another picture? I don't know what we got left here. Let's see. Oh, yeah. What do you see here? This one's not quite as easy, is it? This is a tough one. What do you see? Chin, do you have a close-up there? I think it's a, yeah. Let's take, I took these pictures myself. This is in Haiti. And I knew I would have to take these pictures because there's no way I could explain this to you. Because if I told you what you're looking at, if you didn't see it, you'd think I was lying. So let me explain what you're looking at. In the nation of Haiti, where still to this day, years after the earthquake, 100, 200 kids a week die of starvation. Yeah, I'm going to ask you. I wasn't going to, but I'm going to. Have you ever held a dying child? Probably not, huh? Maybe you'll get to do that someday. Maybe some of you will get to go with me some of the places I go. You up for that? Nah, you ain't up for that, are you? I know. So I guess I just got to show you the pictures, huh? And then you watch their eyes go back, and they're gone. Just that fast. They're gone. It's not like the movies. Not even close. And so they're crying because they're just hungry. I still have a deformed rib cage right here because I had rickets from malnutrition when I was little. I'm reminded every day when I take a shower. Every day. Every day. They cry uncontrollably until they die. I hope you thank God every day you live where you live. And you have a church like this to come to that cares about you. I hope you're smart enough to understand that today. So what the government does, they take dirt, mix it with water, and they make these. They put them outside. That's where I took this picture. They let them dry, and then they stack them in piles. They actually call them mud pies. The government calls them mud pies. So when the kids are crying and just crying and screaming because they're hungry, the government feeds them dirt. But you didn't know that, did you? Now you do. What do you see now? See, you didn't really know what you were looking at, did you? Now you know. Now you know. Maybe you'll get to go with me someday. Maybe. What do you see? Take the picture down, Chin. Mary looks in. Blepo. She doesn't get it. Peter looks in. Theorio. He's trying to figure it out. But then John comes to the tomb. Verse 8. Yeah, most of the translations kind of get it right. He saw. That word saw. Different Greek word again. It's either see or saw in your Bible, but in the Greek, it's another Greek word. It's the Greek word eido, E-I-D-O, eido. It's a silent E. You know what eido means in the Greek? The translation, or the transliteration, kind of gets it right. He sees and he believes. Come on. He looks in the tomb. Looks at the tomb. And he goes, yep, he's gone. He's gone. He did exactly what he said he would do. He saw and he believed. Mary just saw with her eyes. Peter saw with his mind. But John, come on, come on. John saw with his heart. What do you see today? What do you see? The question that has to be answered. What do you see? Mary, Peter, John, they all knew Jesus. They all heard the same messages. All saw the miracles, didn't they? Yeah. Funny how we all see things differently, isn't it? Not that funny. Chin, you got another picture there? This little boy was left on the side of the road outside the orphanage in Haiti. I talked about him a little bit when I was here a couple years ago, but I wanted to finish with this today because there's just more to the story. Nobody wanted him. He was dying. Girls didn't know what to do. They sent me this picture. I said, get him on a plane. Get him to the States. I've got some Christian doctor friends. They said, we can't get him on a plane, Pastor Bill. I said, you need money? I have Western Union money. What do you need? They said, he was born in the bush. Consequently, he doesn't have a birth certificate. If you don't have a birth certificate, you can't get a passport. No passport, no plane. We all know the drill. I said, so all we need is a birth certificate. Is that what y'all are saying? They said, yes. And I said, I'll be there tomorrow. You heard what I said. I'll be there tomorrow. I'm the pastor of the largest Sunday school in the world. And I'm going to drop everything in New York, fly to Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and do what exactly? You know what I did. Sure you do. I found a guy that makes fake birth certificates. American money goes a long way in certain parts of the world. Got a fake birth certificate. Got a fake passport. Got him on a plane. You say, oh, but you broke the law. Oh, I forgot. You wouldn't do that. You're Malaysian. I'm sorry, I had a brain fade for a moment. You wouldn't do that, would you? Would you? See, that's the difference between me and you. It's always been whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. What do you see here? When I saw this picture, I thought I saw something. Maybe I was wrong, but I thought I saw something. Got him to the States, and not one of my Christian doctor friends would operate. Not one. They said, Bill, the kid's going to die. The hospital we work at will not be responsible. They feel like it's too big of a liability. Kid dies. Well, not one. Not one. So I guess it's just easier to let the kid die, isn't it, than be responsible. Apparently, I found one doctor. Miami Children's Hospital wasn't even a Christian. I'm shocked. He said, preacher, he said, we'll do the operation. He said, but you're going to have to sign a waiver that when the boy dies, because he will die. I said, you're that sure? He said, oh, yes. It's too far gone now. His organs are closing up. It's too late. He said, you'll have to sign a waiver that when the boy dies, we will not be responsible. I said, okay. I said, but doc, do me one thing. He said, what's that? I said, please tell me. You won't give up on the boy. See, there was somebody who didn't give up on me. Right? One man. You get it? Get it? One man didn't give up on me. My mother didn't care. She walked, but one guy stopped. So, 7.5 hours in surgery. The nurse comes out in the middle of the operation. She comes to me, she says, he's dying. I said, is he dead yet? She said, no, but his lungs have collapsed. His kidneys are down. I said, is he dead yet? She said, no. I said, please remind Doc. Please. Please. What do you do, folks, when you've done everything you know to do? I did everything I knew, guys. Everything. I prayed. You ever pray so much that after a while you're praying the same prayer over and over? Because you don't know what else to pray. You ever cry so much you got no tears left? Some of you are young. You haven't done that yet, have you? But if you live long enough, you'll cry till you got nothing left. Nothing. I broke the law. Did everything I knew. What do? I walked over to the wall in the waiting room. I put my head against the wall. You know what I said. I said, he shall live and not die. He shall live, not die. Chin, do you have another picture? That's the boy. Come on, give God a praise. Come on. Come on, guys. Yep. His name's Lubinson. He's my buddy. Yeah. They did a pretty good job. Yeah, pretty good. He doesn't have any teeth. We're getting him some teeth now. What do you see now? See, you didn't know how that story was going to end, did you? Yeah. Me neither. That's a special little boy right there, isn't it? He doesn't understand yet what happened. But they'll tell him the story. They'll tell him how an old preacher fought for him. Gave it all I had. What do you see now? Mary didn't connect, did it? She didn't get it. Peter tried. John looked and went, yep. He rose. He's alive. We're good. We're good. What do you see? If this nation is going to change, if we are going to have an influence in this part of the world, folks, somebody is going to have to see something different. Amen.